So we talked about how, you know, right now this is just one model file, and you can imagine that there's lots of model files. So so if you go back to the model itself, I would imagine that one thing we would do is, you know, this controller and this plant, you know, they would probably be worked on independently one another. Maybe one team is building up the model of the controller, another team is building up a model of the plant, and this top level model would just, you know, reference those things. So, you know, how would we do that? I think it's with model blocks and subsystems.
Yes, subsystems and model blocks are the way to go about doing that. So imagine you have, right now we have just one block within the PID controller, but imagine there are several blocks, and you can select all those blocks that correspond to that specific function, like controller in this case. And you can create subsystem using one of these action items that show up upon selection.
Okay.
You have a bunch of items here, but I'll create a subsystem using the first action here.
Sounds good.
And that would create a subsystem for me. And if you look inside, it's just the same blocks. We, in this case, we have only one block, but and then it creates input and output ports. And you can name the subsystem.
Yeah, just controller.
Yeah. And then you can do something very similar to plant. Create a subsystem, just as I did for the controller. And then when I double click, it's the same thing. You can call it plant. And now we can go one step more from here and create a model reference out of this subsystem.
Okay. So, yeah, important point here is that when you're creating these subsystems right here, this is purely a graphical convenience. It's a way to encapsulate, you know, lots of blocks. You only did one block here, but, you know, you can put any, you know, number of blocks inside of these subsystems, and it just makes for a cleaner looking diagram. What you're going to do now is actually create it so that this is a separate model that can be worked on independently from this top level model.
Yeah, so I'm converting this subsystem to a model, another Simulink model essentially.
Yeah.
And while doing that, Simulink brings up this conversion advisor, which has a few checks that will you know, check for the subsystem properties and then convert that subsystem into another Simulink model.
Okay.
So that becomes a separate component on its own. And sometimes if it finds issues like this one, like Michael just mentioned, these are just a visual convenience. The subsystems are just a visual convenience. It doesn't get treated as a single unit.
Right. Yeah, you actually have to specify that a subsystem is what we call an atomic subsystem.
Exactly.
In order for Simulink to treat it as unit, let's say.
A separate component on its own.
Yeah, a separate component.
Yeah.
Otherwise, Simulink doesn't look at it like that. So that's all this conversion advisor is saying is, okay, this really needs to be an atomic subsystem before we do the conversion.
Yeah. It says it's a virtual subsystem, and
it
gives some instructions to make it an atomic subsystem.
Okay.
And I can follow those instructions and do it on my own, or
right click, go to block parameters, but it's much easier to just click
the fix button.
That.
And the fix button just does exactly the same thing. It changes that parameter, and then I can hit continue to continue the conversion process. So once the conversion is done, the block gets updated to another Simulink model.
Yep. So now it's a model block.
Yeah. If I double click it, it's a completely different, separate model.
Right.
And it's called plant. And if we go back to our projects, we can actually go to all files view, and you will notice there are all these other files that get created in addition to the plant model that is not in your project at the moment.
Yeah. So we need to add this back in.
Yeah. But is it just the plant model? Are there any other files that we are missing? We don't know, right? We know that it's plant model is the only one. So we can use dependency analysis for finding all those files. So if I click analyze, first of all, it tells me that my model is not saved. So I'll go back to my, model and just hit save. And then go back to the project and analyze this again. And that then recognizes that there is another file mm-hmm. called plant that's missing. It's not in the project.
It's not in the project right now. So you just add it to the project.
Yeah. Simply right-click, add it to the project, and that's all set.
Yeah, so this is a good point because you're not going to be the only one working on this project at some point. And if others are making changes you need to know if they've added additional files or references or links to the project itself, this is a very handy tool to do that. You see all the dependencies. You've got libraries. You might have scripts.
Yes.
All these other types of things would be shown within the dependency analysis view.
Yeah. Nice thing is it also shows generated files. Like if someone generated code, those files also appear here. So even though they are generated, it shows up as under dependency analysis. So that makes it much more useful.
And we see here that before it only contained three files. Now it does show plant.
And it also shows the statuses in project.
Excellent.
And you can then share this project. We have several options. You can zip it and send it to all your colleagues. It happens a lot of times. You would send a model, you forget the data file. Now you can send the entire project to your team. And you can also send it via GitHub. That's another option if you are using Git as your source control tool. And lastly, what I wanted to show is basically we can add additional labels if you want here for that to show up here in your Simulink project too.